Welcome to Tabletop Gaming Guild's playthrough of Stationfall by Iron Game Design. Today we have the designer Matt with us, and always your hosts, James, Peter, and Dan are here, and we're going to do a playthrough. So without further ado, let's go ahead and get this thing started.
This is Stationfall. It's a tactical intrigue game that takes place on a dying or doomed space station. So you can see the space station here in the is the map. And the idea is that over the course of the game, there's going to be lots of robots and humans, and they're going to be interacting, but the whole thing's going to be on a timer. So based on the number of players, we'll have a certain number of turns to try to complete whatever your victory conditions are. Now, the victory conditions of a particular character are based on the character. So we'll deal out, when we actually set up the game, we'll deal out a whole bunch of different characters here. But the medical robot, for example, the victory conditions are in the bottom left of the card. And so the medical robot wants to be really useful. So they'll score 2 points if there's no downed humans on board at, and then the station is station fall. In other words, the end of the game when the station crashes into Earth's atmosphere and breaks apart. They'll also gain a point for every human that they've revived over the course of the game, and they'll gain a point for every cube moved to betrayal upon their reveal. So the medical robot on board is going to have certain victory conditions, but the sort of hook of the game is that the medical robot might be a player or they might not be a player. And the only time that the medical robot actually cares about being really useful, about scoring those points, is if they're a player. And whether they're a player is unknown, generally unknown to you. So we'll deal out a bunch of character cards. And we can set this up for a 4-player game. And each one of these character cards is going to have a identity card associated with it. So the character cards are face up and visible to everybody. But the identity cards are going to be secret, and they're going to be dealt out to each player. And you're going to actually receive 2 identity cards. So you'll receive one, maybe it's the Astro Chimp, and then the other, maybe it's the medical robot. And you'll make a decision at the beginning of the game which one of those 2 characters you most likely want to be. It's not a binding decision at that point, but you'll pick one of the characters to try to actually be your secret identity. And so you'll know who the characters are in the game, and you will know what the victory conditions are for the individual characters. What you will not know is which players, if any, are those particular characters. Everyone with me so far?
Yes.
All right.
Sure.
Okay. I call it an intrigue game. I'm a little wary of the social deduction or moniker, because while it can be incredibly useful in the game, and if you want to play it very well, you should. Trying to speculate as to who they are, it's not at all necessary to do so to win. To win, you just want to try to accomplish your own tasks, whatever they are, and score the most points. So the next thing I'll talk about, I guess, is the station itself. And the pink areas are the hub. So you can imagine this is a, you can kind of see it on the box up here. You can kind of see what the station sort of looks like. Seen better days, I suppose. But there's a central hub sort of running down the length of the station. And then there's 2 rings that are rotating around it. And so the pink sections are hub sections, and they don't have gravity. And this can be relevant for certain movement and stuff like that in the game. But it's just important to note that anytime you're looking at this and trying to figure out what connects to what, these pink corridors means that you're connecting 2 pink sections to each other. If it's a two-colored corridor, like maybe this guy here, that means you're actually going out from the hub and up into one of the rings. So this is the orange ring here. This is the forward ring. So these orange sections pretty much all connect to each other in sort of a ring format, and even behind. So you'll see this is the physics lab here, and there's a little thing. It's, you know, it's kind of weird because it's a three-dimensional angle here, but it leads to the mainframe. So you can see that goes behind there. The blue ring, the rear ring, has the same effect. There's the quarters here, and it kind of goes behind to the therapy garden. So even those two spots are somewhat disparate on the map, they're directly connected to each other. The other thing I want to talk about, I mean, there's lots of funny little places on the map and things you can do things, and we'll explore some of those during the course of play, but is many characters, not all, but many characters care about surviving. And so it is possible to survive in this game. And to do so, you'll need to escape. So that's the only thing you need to do. Even if someone just drags your body off the station and puts you in an escape pod, you've escaped, and it's presumed that the medical services on Earth are really, really good. All you got to do is escape to meet those victory conditions. And so different characters, you'll see like the Astro Chimp has 3 victory points if, and it's got a little Earth symbol. So anytime you're looking at symbology, you can always just look at this. I think it's described as Rosetta Stone over here. And hopefully on here somewhere, you'll see a little Earth symbol. And that's going to mean escape. So any character that has a little Earth thing on here is going to try to survive. And they're generally going to be the humans and not necessarily their way to one of the escape pods on the station. And the escape pods are here at the top. This is actually the rear of the station up here. And this is the aft airlocks that attaches to them. So if you want to get there, you're going to have to go through the hub. So you can't go through the blue ring. You can imagine the blue ring is about as far away as you can get from the rear hub here. So if you get in one of these pods, then you can do one of the pod launch actions or something like that and actually escape. And if you do so, then we'll move the little pod down to the mesosphere, and whatever characters on board are pretty much out of the game, but they have escaped and survived. All right. Any other questions just about the geography of the map in general?
Yeah, the dotted lines, are those the vents?
Yes, dotted okay. lines are vents. The orange dashes, those are also, it's unusable by most characters. Only special characters can actually use those things. I want to go back to characters here, and I just want to mention that all of the characters in the game have abilities, and they're in these colored sections here, or parts of the card, and the colors of the particular abilities match sort of the function of the ability. So anything green is going to be some sort of defensive ability. Anything red is going to be some sort of offensive ability. Anything purple is going to have to do with your conspirator cubes or influence cubes, which I'll discuss in a minute. But the point is that those characters possess those abilities always. So the Daredevil has the Adrenaline ability and the Pride ability, whether they're a player or not. But there are certain special abilities that only occur and only come into play once a player has revealed themselves as a particular character. And these are on the bottom right of the cards. So for Daredevil, that's the Point Break ability. For the Microbiologist, that's the Contagious ability, etc. And so during the course of play, you're going to, as a player, make a decision as to whether and or when to reveal yourself as a particular character. Now, as soon as you do, everyone else knows who you are, which is a negative, obviously. they'll know your victory conditions. They'll know they might track you down and try to smack you with a wrench or something. Give you a certain, usually powerful special ability of some sort, and that's listed in the bottom right of the particular character. All right, we good? Are we good on that general concept so far?
Yep.
Yes.
All right. So, how to interact in the game? What do you actually do on your turn or during the course of your turn? So, what you will be doing is you'll follow the sequence of play, which I don't know if it's been moved off or maybe it's in here.
There's a sheet next to our sheet.
It's been added to the sheet. Step one, reveal. So it says optional. In other words, you can choose whether or not you would like to reveal your secret identity card. So as I discussed, revealing has certain consequences. And if you want to gain your super secret ability, you're going to have to reveal. Step two, influence. So influence is also optional, but it's the primary way that you're going to interact with these characters. So you as a player, as a particular colored cube, you will decide whether you want to place one or more of your influence cubes on a particular character. You can place as many as you want, but you can only place it on a single character during a single influence phase. Okay, these cubes are sort of like your currency. They're sort of like your investments in the game, and they're persistent. So they're not there are ways that they can come back to you, but as soon as, let's say, I drop two cubes on the microbiologist here, that's a significant amount of influence on the microbiologist, and that means the microbiologist will do things that I want them to do. But if someone comes in and goes over the top of me, let's say they drop three on there, then the microbiologist will stop listening to me, and I would have to at least tie for them to start doing stuff I want them to do. So these cubes don't return easily, and you want to be thoughtful about them. You have a literal component limit of 8 cubes. However, you have a secret influence limit based on who you decide to be when you reveal. And that's this number here in the small cube next to the icon of your particular character. So these are all fairly similar. 3 is extremely low. So the billionaire is not very likable, I suppose. 5 is fairly average. So there's none of the real heavy hitter influencers in the game right now. But that means that if at the end of the game you use more cubes than that number, then you will lose a point for every cube that you go over. And a victory point's fairly substantial in this game. So just be mindful, I guess, of going over your cube limit. All right, so the next phase is activation. This is where you actually do something with somebody. So let's say I had done that. I had done during my influence phase, I put 2 cubes on the microbiologist. The next thing I can do is I can place an activation disc on them if I want to activate them during my turn. And that means I want to do stuff with the microbiologist. So let's go grab the microbiologist and put them somewhere. We'll figure out where they start later. And now there's a couple of things you can do. First of all, when you activate a character, you'll see a list of sort of basic actions here on your sheet. Attacking, copying, giving, picking up, stuff like that. You will get 2 basic actions during your turn when you activate a character. So let's say I activate the microbiologist, I can do 2 basic actions. Now, anytime you activate a character, you also get a free pickup or drop. So, this character here, if they're in the storm shelter, their first free action, which won't count towards their 2, could be to pick up this helmet here, and we just go stick it in their inventory. And then for their second action, I could move them to the tanks. And then as their third action, maybe I could activate this section here. Maybe I could decontaminate because the microbiologist starts with a contamination marker. I could clean myself off in the tanks and get rid of my contamination marker. And that would be a activation phase for me. Now, let's say everyone goes and it comes back around to me. It's my turn to influence again, and maybe I can go drop a cube on somebody, maybe the lawyer robot or something. And the decision then comes to, hey, it's activation time again. And I can leave my activation disc here and activate the microbiologist again, or I could move it to the lawyer or any character that I have at least tied for the most cubes on. And I can activate that character. But here's the thing to remember is that if there's already a disc on an activation disc on a character, then you can still activate them. So for example, let's say that this is how it looks. I've got at least tied for the most cubes on legal, right? I could activate legal. That's perfectly fine. I would only get one action. So one basic action instead of two. So in this way, the game is going to reward you for diversifying character play. And so you may not just want to pick a particular character and just keep running with them every single turn because it's very action inefficient. And it would be just as efficient if you can pull it off to bounce back to this character. Yeah, I could go do an action with legal and then come back and do two actions with the microbiologist the following turn or something like that. It's just something to keep in mind when you're deciding who and where and when to activate. All right, we good on that?
How many actions do you get with the microbiologist if you leave your token on him and decide to use him again?
Great question.
It's just the one, or
you will get just the one. If there's one or more discs on the card at the start of your turn, then you will just get the one.
Okay.
And somebody else coming in would also just get the one. Now, there's some abilities that might change this. I'm actually going to swap the legal robot out just because it's a very complicated character, and we'll find someone more sane to bring in. All right. Okay. All right. So those are the basic ways that you're going to be interacting with the game. You're going to be using your cubes to influence particular characters. And then during your activation phase, you're going to choose which characters you want to activate, character you want to activate, and you'll do stuff with them. And there's lots of things to do on the station, and I'll go into those in a little bit. But first of all, I want to go ahead and set the game up just because I think a lot of the rest of this will make more sense if you're looking at your secret identity characters and are trying to make decisions based on that. So, but in the meantime, I'm also happy to answer further questions. I'll note that these characters can also modify the game. So for example, because the engineer is in the game, so there's 27 characters or so, we're just going to be playing with 12 that we've pretty much randomly chosen here. But because the engineer is in the game, the reactor is going to be a little more dangerous. It's going to be a nuclear reactor or a fission reactor, I should say. And so it can change the station slightly by having the engineer on board. Also, because the next character I see is the digital assistant, I know that the digital assistant also tweaks the game to some extent. Let's see what I did this wrong. And this actually makes it so that the section action, there's a new console action. A console is like the computer action, right? But because the digital assistant's in the game, now you can actually lock things or unlock things or move locks around and stuff like that using console actions. Obviously, I haven't talked about console actions, but the basic idea is that if you go to one of the computer panels, there's one here in the mainframe, and there's one here in the security station, and you can see the little icon for it. Then you can do console actions. So you can see what the console actions are down here. And you can turn the jammers on and off, or you can try to put out a fire, or you can add or move a lock or something like that. So the characters being in the game can tweak the way the station actually functions, I guess. Maybe that's the way of putting it. All right, and the mainframe is going to be slightly different because that's where you can actually manufacture this. The digital assistant is a weird, another weird character, but we'll just leave him in the game. We'll roll with it. The digital assistant is not a human or a robot. So most of the characters are humans or robots, and you can see this is a human. They've got a nice green hex-looking thing. The engineer is a human. Some characters not humans, like the robot, the medical robot, or looks like the drones in the game. But the digital assistant is actually Data, and I'll talk more about Data later. But this is a non-corporeal character. This is not a character that's going to walk around and directly pick things up and throw things and smash each other or do stuff like that. All right, so I got the digital assistant card. Moving on to the medical robot. Grab medical here. Throw their compromat in a bag. Any other questions while I'm setting up? I can set up pretty much on autopilot.
Well, let me just take a look at the board and see what's going on.
Sure.
It's a lot of character options.
I'm doing a full teach here, but of course, if you guys have read the rules or anything, I don't mind speeding things up. I had planned to sit out the game, and then I can answer questions during the course of it.
Maybe while you're setting up there, if no one has any questions, if you want to talk a little bit about like how he came up with the game and stuff.
Oh, how I came up with the game. This project has been around for a long time. And so, several years, but it certainly was inspired by the artifact. Now, this is a project, a Sierra Madre Games release once upon a time that itself was based heavily on the Vesuvius incident, which is a solitaire game, sort of like an alien style game. But the Vesuvius incident, which was Fat Messiah Games and Neil Sofchi, had an awesome science vessel with... I mean, this station is heavily based on it. It had a hub, and it had a command pod or something, and it had a gravity ring that was full of all sorts of interesting and obscure locations, like a kitchens and labs sort of intermingled. And I really liked style of that game, and. I tried to. The artifact is a quadruple blind board game. It is a wildly overly ambitious game that had no real hope of ever becoming mainstream. But it was so cool that I tried to revisit the project many years later. In order to build something that was at least somewhat like it. And when I first started trying to build a game that had a diversity of sort of secret characters trying to fight it out on in a tactical environment, which the artifact and the Vesuvius incident and stuff like that were heavily built upon, I put the whole thing in a castle. It was actually called Castlefall when the whole project was originally Castlefall. And I drew the map over a 3D cutout of a castle. And it had all these, you know, neat things and, you know, special victory conditions, stuff like that. But I struggled trying to explain how it was that the players could communicate with any character anywhere at any time, if that makes any sense. And it, you know, how are you supposed to communicate to the assassin hidden in the tower that, you know, right now he needs to switch sides and, you know, go do this other thing instead of listening to the person he was first listening to? Because it, the whole thing plays out in a very short amount of time, I had to shift it. So I put it back onto a space station, and it's evolved from there. And it has it has definitely evolved. The game is new characters and new ideas and other bad ideas getting taken out, and there's been quite a bit of work over the course of time on Stationfall, while the core rule set has pretty much been stable. So I want to mention that the when you're looking at some of the abilities in the game, the colored abilities that are on the particular character, one thing you want to pay close attention to are the purple ones. So the purple ones actually affect your ability to influence a particular character. So some of them make it easier and some of them make it harder, but I just want to talk about the kernel. I'm not really going to go through each of the characters necessarily one by one and explain all their little intricacies, but the kernel is paranoid. And paranoid is an ability which means that if you want to influence them, so in other words, if you want to place a cube on them, you will need to have a co-located conspirator. And once again, a conspirator is just anyone that you're at least tied for the most cubes with. So the colonel is paranoid and is not going to trust his comms. So the colonel is going to require someone face to face to take care of their or to convince them to join your side or whatever. All right, I see the drones are also in the game. So the drones are another strange character. The drones are, first of all, there's two of them. And let's see, physics lab and EVA. The drones are the only character in the game that don't have an identity card. So no one is going to be the drones. The drones are literal, like, remote controlled, like forklifts or something. And so you can drive them and do stuff with them just by using a console action, but they are not, you won't be influencing them. You won't be bribing them. You won't be trying to blackmail them, which are two concepts I haven't gotten into just yet, but you're not going to be interacting with them the same way you're going to interact with all these other characters. These are more like just pawns that change the state of the game. All right. I think I have set this up, but man, I am a card short. Oh, maybe I didn't grab the microbiologist card. Yep, here we go. All right, so I'm shuffling the identity cards. I'm now going to deal two identity cards to each player. And you can take a look at those, but those identity cards are going to have a certain set of information on them. And the first thing they're going to show is your victory conditions, right? Which are going to be the same as the ones that are on the character card itself. Then it's going to give you a little tip, right? A little introduction to the character. Like, here are things that you might be able to do to try to help you accomplish your goals. Then it's going to discuss your on reveal powers. So if it has a little eyeball associated with it, that means that that's some cool ability that you will only have if you reveal as that particular character. And the last thing I want to talk about, because this is the decision you're making right now, is going to be your bonus card. I want to talk about your bonus card. So you've been dealt two identity cards, and you're going to choose one of them to be your secret identity, or your most likely secret identity. And the other one you're going to flip upside down in your hand. And you'll see at the bottom of your of any given card, you'll see little blue or little green shields, or maybe little red target icons, or maybe little blue shields, I think. If there's little shields on it, then that means that you care about that character's survival. So as an example, let's say I'm taking two characters that are not in our game. I've got the operative in my hand, and I've got the troubleshooter in my hand. Let's say I flip the troubleshooter upside down as my bonus card, which means that the operative is my secret identity. So this means I'm going to be trying to accomplish the operative's victory conditions. Okay, I'm ignoring the troubleshooter's victory conditions for now, or I shouldn't say ignore it, but I'm not going to. I'm tentatively not going to be scoring those points. I'm going to be trying to accomplish the victory conditions on the operative. However, in addition to those, the operative is apparently friends with the troubleshooter and actually cares about the troubleshooter and wants the troubleshooter to fill in the blank, survive. In this case, there's two green shields. That means that you will get two additional points if the troubleshooter escapes. Okay, the little shields, we'll probably change them into little earths at some point, but those mean that you want this particular character to escape. So you could be the operative and be friends with the troubleshooter. That's what this means. Now let's say it's the opposite. Let's say you go with the troubleshooter and then you flip the operative. Well, now you're trying to get your primary points from the troubleshooter's victory conditions. And you do. You care about the operative as well. However, they're little target icons, not little shields. And that means that you do care about the operative in a negative fashion. That means you want the operative to actually be murdered before the station burns up. So you don't want to let them just go down with the ship. You actually want to seek them out and hunt them down and have them already be downed and not escaped at the time of station fall. And if you succeed at that, then you'll get 2 points. You'll get 2 points for that. Now, I say murder, which is the game calls it down. There's two states a character, human or a robot, can be in, down or alive. It's somewhat temporary because there's lots of ways to resuscitate humans or robots. Robots usually require some sort of special ability, or you can repair any robot inside the machine shop. And for humans, you can repair them with nanomeds, which is a particular item in the game, or the medical robot, as you can imagine, is pretty good at that. And you can see he's got an ability that is attuned to trying to heal humans. So characters will get downed and then maybe undowned over the course of play. The only thing I want to mention is that if a character is downed, and the corpsicle actually starts downed, so I'll go ahead and do that. I'll flip the corpsicle here. The corpsicle is frozen at the beginning of the game and needs to be revived in order to do anything. And they're here in the cryo lab. That's an example of what downing means. You can't activate a downed character. So before you guys pick, I just want to do a brief intro to all the different characters. The engineer is here, starts in array control. And if the engineer is a player, then they will be interested in preserving Earth's ecosphere. The engineer, in order to do that, there's a number of ways. Step one is to make sure that no contaminated characters escape. Now, any character that goes into the biolab becomes contaminated. But we've also started with a contaminated character. The microbiologist actually starts contaminated. So the engineer will score 4 points if no contaminated characters escape. Also, if you manage to detonate the antimatter on board before station fall, so instead of letting the station break up in the atmosphere, you actually set off the self-destruct and annihilate everything with the power of antimatter, that'll give you some more points. Also, you don't want the artifact to escape. Does not escape. The artifact is that little symbol there. The artifact is here in the physics lab. It's just a unique item. It's just an item. It's in the physics lab, but the engineer cares about it. You also score a point if you're innocent, but you can win even if you're guilty. I'll talk about the innocent guilty track later. All right, the digital assistant is the next character. This is Data. So once again, this is not a character that's walking and talking and moving around the station. This is a piece of data that can be copied, and you can manufacture the data here in the mainframe. And as soon as a character has the data, they can copy it to other characters. Now, there's several different types of data in the game. In our game, we'll have three, it looks like. We will have the evidence, which is relevant for some victory conditions, but also for guilt, which I'll talk about. The digital assistant, which is, of course, relevant to anyone who cares about the digital assistant. And the X secret, which is top secret information related to the horrible experiment on board, which is random and which I've dealt us a random one here. All right, so digital assistant can be copied to other characters, so co-located characters. If the jammers ever get turned off, jammers start the game on, but if they're ever turned off, you can actually copy it to anyone on board. So this goes for evidence or the X secret or copies of the digital assistant.
Where are those jammers again? I missed the ping.
Great question. The jammers are actually here. They're part of the console actions. Okay. So as a console action, however you do it, maybe you'll do it by being in the mainframe, or maybe you'll do it by being in the security station, or maybe there's a hacker on board, or the digital assistant as a character always can perform. In fact, it can only perform console actions. If you want to turn the jammers off, the digital assistant will be the first one to happily comply with your request. We would just turn it off like this. And then you could see you can copy data to any character on board. So that would just be a console action to turn the jammers off. Also, if the power on the station ever gets interrupted in any way, then the cameras and jammers will immediately turn off. All right, moving on to the medical robot. The medical robot is here in the aft hub. As I mentioned before, they really want to revive humans and make sure there's no downed humans on board. That's how they're going to score the majority of their points. And so that's how the medical robot scores. I'll just mention that, on reveal, the medical robot will pick up a tool, and tools are really dangerous weapons in the game. The medical robot doesn't care about survival. The medical robot doesn't care about escaping. It doesn't care if any of the humans escape. It's not a long-term health care professional. It is a are you bleeding on the ground right now sort. And so the medical robot also doesn't care if it was the one who caused the harm in the first place. That's beside the point, as long as you received good medical service. All right. Moving on to the corpsicle. The corpsicle is trying to escape and survive, but also wants to make sure that the biological contamination also survives, because that's their only hope for living a long life. I think of this character as some old, terminally ill individual who's put themselves on ice. This is a difficult character to get to survive. You get a lot of bonus points if they're your friend and you get them to survive. You also score quite a few points if you are them and you try to survive, but you're also trying to get out with the contamination. So they're going to care a lot about contamination. Just as a reminder, there is one character that starts contaminated, but also any human or robot that enters the bio lab will become contaminated. Step one, if you want the corpsicle to survive, is going to be to find a way to revive them. That's going to mean bringing them meds, nanomeds, which could be found in the locker room or manufactured in the med lab, or you could send the medical robot to just do it themselves with their ability. The Astro Chimp is the next character. They start in the kitchen. The Astro Chimp just wants shiny things. Step one, they really want to escape. So this is the first, well, this isn't the first character. This is one character that has the little pluses next to their victory points. And I want to highlight it because it's important. Three victory points of escape. Okay, that's normal. That's understandable. Chimp wants to live. However, the plus two if possess briefcase, plus two if possess artifact, plus two if possess gun. Those plus victory points will only be scored if you accomplished that first thing. The thing that it doesn't have a plus that's above it. The chimp doesn't care about having a gun or an artifact if they burn up on reentry. They want to escape first and foremost. It would be great if they had some shiny things when they do. Makes sense. Sound reasonable. And that's going to be for all of these guys that have pluses. You're going to want to look at the victory condition immediately above it and do that first. All right, the stowaway. First of all, the stowaway doesn't start on the map, and the stowaway's first action has to be to place on the map in any dark section. So if you want someone to get to one of these dark places quickly or for some reason, then the stowaway is an option to do it. Stowaway also has that tunnel rat ability we talked about, so they can move through the vents. Oh, so does the chimp for that matter. Stowaway also has hacker, so if the jammers are off, they can perform console actions anywhere. Victory condition wise, the stowaway, if they are a player, then they will be an undercover reporter, some reporter hiding on board the station and trying to scoop all their rivals. And they're going to care a lot about data. They're going to care about that X secret data, which once again can be manufactured here in the biolab. They're going to care about the evidence, which can be manufactured here in the security station. And they're going to want to escape if at all possible. They're going to want to try to survive and hopefully be the only one that escapes with the evidence in the game. Now, I'll also mention that with any data, you can actually send it off the station. So even if you don't get out alive, you can send it off the station. So the stowaway, for example, the only place to do that from is the array control here in the center of the station. If the stowaway or any character, if they can just get somebody to send the data to the news using this transmit ability of the array control, that accomplishes some of their tasks. To get some of those points. But if you escape with it, you can also just hand deliver it at the end of the game. So that's sort of a fail safe. If everything's going wrong, at least you can let the world know what you found out as the station crumbles around you. All right. Moving on to the billionaire. The billionaire just wants to live. The billionaire starts in the suite. The billionaire cares about their own survival a lot. But they also care about the survival of their therapy dog, which is here in the security station. it preferably would like to escape with the dog in a pod. Now, I want to mention the ability of the billionaire. The billionaire and the dog have live streams. So the dog and the billionaire have little cameras on their shoulders or something. If the jammers are ever turned off, then all of a sudden everyone on Earth can tune in to the billionaire's channel or whatever and watch what's happening live. And this is relevant because if you down a human in this game, there may be consequences, and I'll talk more about it. But if you down a human while the live streams are rolling, there you will immediately jump through all the levels of consequences and jump straight to guilty. And guilty players cannot win. So unless your victory condition says otherwise, like the engineer's does, guilty players cannot win. So if the chimp shoots somebody in front of the billionaire or shoots the billionaire on the way out the door and hops in the escape pod and races back to Earth, that chimp will spend the rest of their days incarcerated back on Earth, and they do not win the game, no matter how many shinies they picked up along the way. All right. There's lots of other, you know, special characteristics on all these guys, but this is a game that is part exploration, and we will be doing that together. There's plenty to try to swallow on a first playthrough without me trying to inundate you with every special little thing going on. But I'll let you guys find that stuff on your own. The Exile, Once again, if the exile is a player, the exile is going to be some sort of exiled spy that's going to be trying to get back in the game. They're going to want to escape, step one. And step two, they're going to want compromising material on surviving characters. Now, I haven't talked about compromising material, and so I'll grab one here that you can look at. So here's what the token looks like on its back. And if we flip it over, you will see a little icon for one of the characters, not in our particular game. That's the one for the operative. Okay, so the little tie means, hey, that's the operative's compromat. Stationfall takes the somewhat cynical view that everyone on board has some horrible dark secret that they have tried to hide and can be discovered by other characters. And compromat is going to be an item in the game. And I've already taken all the compromat for the 11 blackmailable characters in our game, not including the drones. And I'm going to go ahead now, actually, and go ahead and place them into play. And I'm going to place them on the little icons that show the little folder that matches the compromat icon. But the basic idea is that these are items that characters can move around and pick up, and just like other items, except that unlike other items, if you pick up a compromat, it immediately goes to the player, not to the character. So if a character picks up a helmet, we will take the helmet and we'll put it on the particular character. If you have a character pick up compromat, we will give it to the player. It'll actually go into your hand and you'll be able to look at it secretly and see whose secret you've picked up. This is useful information because during your turn, you're going to activate, right? We talked about how you place cubes and you're going to place a disc to actually get to do actions, which sounds a lot more complicated than it actually is. But in addition to that, if you want to, you can discard a compromat and do an action with that character, regardless of cubes, or regardless of anything, really. If you have the exile's compromat, you could play the exile's compromat and do one action with the exile, even if somebody else had a ton of cubes on the exile and you had none. That's how compromat works generally. If the circumstances arise that you want to use compromat on a player character, so someone's revealed as the exile and you want to blackmail them, that's an option as well. But we'll get to it if that comes up. All right. But the point is, the exile is going to care a lot about compromat, and the exile is going to want to try to get anyone that he can blackmail to survive. So the exile, if the exile gets the compromat for the billionaire, the exile really wants the billionaire to escape so that the exile can blackmail them back on Earth or something. If the billionaire burns up on reentry with their dog, the exile's top secret embarrassing information for YouTube is not as useful. All right. Moving on to the Daredevil. Daredevil also wants to survive, but wants like a really great story or something. So they want to live. They want to be the only survivor if possible. They would like to either have a cool knickknack, like the artifact, or, I don't know, a cool scar, maybe they having decontaminated when they come back. And also, if possible, they'd like the horrible project to be released before they escape, just so they can say they were there when the monster ate everybody. Okay, that's the Daredevil. I'll let you take a look at their other special stuff as you see fit. All right, the colonel wants to get their weapons test off, the colonel wants to escape and wants the top secret weapons related data if they can get it. They would also like somebody who's been contaminated and is not a player to escape. They also want the horrible project to be released before the end of the game. And they'd like it not to be released during a blackout so they can get some video footage of this thing. A lot of different things going on here. All right. The microbiologist. The microbiologist, if they're a player, then the microbiologist has been undermined by a sentient pathogen. And so the microbiologist is just trying to get the pathogen to escape. And he wants as many contaminated characters as possible to escape. And that's how the microbiologist scores points. So that includes the microbiologist who starts contaminated, but there's lots of other potential contaminees. Once again, anyone who goes in the bio lab becomes contaminated. All right, the drones are not a player. They are not have no identity card and just go about doing the bidding of whoever wants to do a console action. All right, that's an intro to all the characters. The last thing I want to mention is the actions in the game. We've talked about some of them, but movement is an action. Picking up or dropping or throwing an item is an action. Using an item is usually an action. But attacking is the one that I really want to discuss. And it's on 12.8 if you want to go through your rules, you can look at it. But the basic idea is that if you want to attack somebody, you're going to need some sort of weapon to do so. There's two types of weapons in the game. There's tools and there's guns. A tool is good enough to down a robot. A tool is good enough to down a human that is not wearing a helmet. A gun will down whatever it is that you want downed. But all of these are just you have to attack somebody in your own section. There's no ranged combat from that perspective. The other type of weapon in the game is a firebomb. Firebombs can be manufactured here in the chemistry lab. These don't attack in the traditional way. Instead, you'll use the firebomb by throwing it to create a hazard, the hazard being fire. And humans and only humans that have no helmets will be downed if they're in a hazard. So if you throw a firebomb into a room, all the humans without helmets are immediately downed. And the robots just click around like nothing has happened. And humans with helmets will also click around like nothing's happened. Those are the general actions. There's lots of other little actions that you can take a look at, including copying data. Also, each of the sections might have some special little action that you can do there. The airlock action lets you move in and out of EVA. Manufacturing something is an action. Doing a console action is an action. Some actions have the little officer symbol on them. That means you must be an officer to do those. So if you want to set the self-destruct, you can't just be any old schlub who can make it to the bridge. You have to be an officer. So that would mean in our game, the colonel and the engineer are the two officers in our particular game. Those are the two who could do this. But I'll also mention the digital assistant has a special little thing going on, which is characters possessing this data gain officer. So alternatively, you can be anyone with the digital assistant. Then you can set the self-destruct or bypass, which is release the horrible project, or trigger abandon ship early, or launch pods if you want to launch pods. So that's pretty much it. Go ahead at this time, select which character you'd like to be your secret identity and which you'd like to be your bonus card. The last thing I'll mention before I'll take your question is that this decision isn't so critically important. You can actually choose when you reveal to reveal as your bonus card. It's called a Schrodinger reveal. But if you do that, you'll discard your original secret identity. So in other words, you will not have a bonus card. So it lowers your scoring potential when you do so. But if you pick somebody and then you see, well, this isn't going to work out, then maybe it's the right choice. All right. Fire away with questions.
I'm sorry. I was just you're going to get back to this guilty, suspect, innocent.
Yes, I will do that. But I'm also noticing since we only have three players, we're actually going to deal out one more identity card to each player. And so one of them will be your secret identity and two will be your bonus cards. If you do the Schrodinger reveal, you can actually, you'll discard both of your bonus cards. All right. Yes. Talking about guilt and innocence. So everybody starts the game rather optimistically, perhaps, as innocent. So nobody at the start of the game is suspected of anything. However, if you ever down a human in a lit section with cameras on, so the cameras in the game start on, they can be turned off in the security section, but you'll see that there. The cameras start on. So if you down a human, regardless of how you do it, if you throw a firebomb and they light on fire and die, or if you hit them over the head with a wrench, or if you irradiate them by blowing up the reactor, whatever it is, whatever means you creatively find a way to down a human, if it's in a lit section, so not in the dark section, you can see the little really dark areas for the dark sections, and the cameras are on, then you are going to become a suspect. Now, just being a suspect's not game over, right? Everything's A-okay. If they just think you did it, but they can't prove it, then you're fine. However, if the evidence is transmitted to the authorities, all suspects become guilty. So remember, the evidence is just data that can be manufactured in the security section. And you can bet if you become a suspect that there's going to be heightened interest in getting the evidence off the station to remove you from contention as a guilty player. I'll also mention that if you become guilty, let's say you hit somebody and then they send the evidence to the authorities, if you escape with a copy of the evidence, whether through deep fakery or some other, maybe you turn state's evidence and you're cooperating with the prosecutors. If you escape with the evidence, you can move back down to suspect from guilty. So it's not game over if you become guilty. You could still get the evidence yourself and escape with the evidence. Then you will still be in contention. I'll also mention that if you reject a compromat, so if someone uses a compromat on you, remember, you being a revealed you, a PC, and you say no, then you become a suspect. So the horrible crime gets posted on YouTube and your past is blown wide open and now you're a suspect. All right, so you should be flipping in your hand two of your three cards and leaving your secret identity face up. And also, other questions at this time, please fire away.
No, I think I'm pretty good. Peter, what's your secret identity?
Yeah, so I am...
How about you, Dan?
James always has to try, and he always has to try first with me.
I'm the operative, actually.
Yeah, there you go. That's good. That's going to freeze them because they're going to spend the next 5 minutes trying to find the operative over here. That's good. Yeah, that's an advantage. You just scored some points with me. All right. Then we're going to go ahead and start our first turn. I'm going to look on the little track thing. It looks like we are on the correct for number of players, three players. Also, I'll randomize this thing and we'll pop that up. Okay. And... and who's Brown? Who's
going I'm Brown.
First? I'm sorry. What's your name?
James.
Hi, James. I'm Matt. Nice to meet you.
All right.
So the first thing you're going to decide is whether or not to reveal as your secret identity or as one of your bonus cards if you're really playing the game terribly. The answer is usually no, but I always want to try to remind people that that is always an option at the start of their turn. The second decision you'll make is who to influence. So who to place a cube on to try to accomplish whatever your task is. Now, I talked all about the players. just as a reminder as to where the things are that people care about. If you care about contamination, it's here in the bio lab. If you care about the artifact, it's here in the physics lab. If you care about the briefcase, it's here in the suite. If you care about the antimatter, it's here in magnetic containment. If you care about the Project X data, which is the one with the little key, you can manufacture that in the bio lab as well. If you care about the Project X being released or something like that, there's a number of ways to do it, but the most obvious is to use the bypass ability in the cryo lab with some sort of officer or find a way to damage the vault that the thing is being stored in.
So I notice there's a lock there. How do you get past the lock?
Yes, there is. you can, as a console action, because the digital assistants in the game, you can move, remove, or add a lock to any corridor. I'll also mention that the officer's ability on their character indicates that they can just walk through locks which are removed. So you can't lock an officer out of anything. And that goes for the digital assistant as well. If the digital assistant is being carried by somebody, they move and act as though they're an officer. The digital assistant has all the little command codes or something like that. I think I got distracted there, but I think I covered most of the things that the things that you might want to pick up or locate or whatever.
Like there's useful items at the print shop, and there's a couple pieces of equipment like helmets and guns scattered throughout the station. So
yes, I'll mention lastly that this thing here is like a rocket pack, because that's only in the game because the Daredevil's in the game. If you manage to get that, you can actually launch from EVA. I didn't talk about EVA. I'll really briefly talk about EVA. These little arrows show the ability to go in and out of. Oh, and there should be one on the aft airlocks. Not sure whether or not they're. Oh, there they are. Woo!
Here, okay. Here.
They just
here and here, right? Clever.
Yes. So those are out arrows only, but these are in and out. The point is, EVA is just a section that represents all the space outside the station. And right now, there's a drone clinging to the outside of the station and driving around repairing things or something. But if you can get EVA and you've got the rocket pack, you can do this little EVA launch, and you can just fly back to Earth. Like, you just fly back to Earth and ignore all these escape pods and whatever else you need to worry about. So that's the rocket pack, which is here. If you want to go EVA, you're going to need a helmet if you're a human. If you're a robot, then you don't care about it. All right, I'm done. I'm done with my spiel. James, I'm going to let you take your turn. Your decisions now are going to be who you would like to influence with one or more cubes and then perform actions with them by activating them.
I shall activate them, and I get two actions, right?
That's right, and a free pickup or drop. Anytime you activate a character, you'll get a free pickup or drop item in addition to your normal basic actions.
Right. So move here. That's where the mainframe is, right?
I'm sorry, I was fixing my glasses. Yes, you'll move here to the forward hub, and then the mainframe is up here. Yes. So to get to the mainframe,
I'll have to take another action in here.
Yep.
And then do I get to pick up that?
You may. As your free pickup drop, you can put that into your hand.
All right. That would be good for me. Right.
And oh, I should set up the turns on this thing. That's what I should do. And voila. All right.
Sorry. Ah. Excellent.
Right. So I did my two actions, so now it's on to someone else, right?
Yes. Okay. Dan, is that you?
Yep. That's me. All right. Sure. Before I know who I'm going to influence, but mm-hmm. before you said when you could choose to reveal, one of your any one of your three cards.
So here's your decision. First, you can decide whether you want to reveal as your secret identity. And if you do, then you'll get to keep your bonus cards. If
okay.
Alternatively, you can reveal as one of your bonus cards. But if you do, you'll discard all your other cards.
Oh, okay. Okay. All right. I'm gonna use the medical robot.
You have to make robot sounds while you move it. No, I'm kidding. Don't do that.
All right, so the first thing, you influence the robot. Now, if you want to activate the robot, you'll place your activation disc onto that
one right there. Okay, yeah. All right.
And you get two actions.
You gonna make a beeline straight for the corpsicle?
Is The purple tokens are all effectively items as well?
Yes, those are unique items.
Okay.
So anything that's square is going to be an item of some sort.
Okay. Just trying to figure out what I can pick up or drop.
Yes. Common first turns involve picking up compromat or helmets or tools, stuff like that.
Now, yeah, I think the medical robot needs a tool.
Okay, that's one action plus your free pickup drop, and you actually have a second action.
Okay. We'll just move them up there.
So the move, you'll have to go back to the aft hub to get up to the third.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I guess, yeah, that's fine.
All right.
All right, now and Peter?
Yeah, that's right. So let's see. I would like to influence the digital assistant.
Ooh.
And activate it. Now for the digital assistant, is it on the board as a token?
It is not on the board as a token.
Okay,
that's
I didn't think so.
Good question. It's data that can be manufactured in the mainframe. So a character could go there and manufacture it. But meanwhile, the digital assistant is sort of in the cloud and can do console actions. So if you want to do any of these things down here, those are options for the digital assistant. In fact, that's really the only thing the digital assistant can do. But you'll get two actions of these. So you could turn off jammers. You could do anything with a drone. So one of the drones is in the physics lab. One of them is EVA. So you can do an action with a drone if you wanted to.
You should take off all the locks. No locks.
Yes, you could unlock Vault X or the anti-magnetic containment or something like that if you're really feeling evil.
Do it.
Way to start an emergency right away, right?
You know what?
I mean, we're already crashing into the stratosphere.
Exactly.
With a little bit more fire. You know, keeps people moving.
That's a really good question here. Well, we're going to go ahead and turn off the jammers.
Flip that and move it over there.
You know you want to release the alien. You know you do.
Where's that one at?
So you can remove this lock if you want to, which will make it easier to get into Vault X. And if you damage this section, then the horrific whatever this is will be released, which might be a monster that eats everybody, or it might be something far more mundane like a death ray or a wormhole.
Yeah, that sounds fun. Let's do that.
Yeah, I like it. I like how you're thinking. Let's do it.
All right, and I will just remove this lock. And so now this corridor here is wide open for movement if anyone is so inclined.
Okay.
All right. Peter, those are two actions with the digital assistant. I'm presuming you're done with your turn?
I am.
All right, I'm going to move the turn marker. Approximately 13 turns left. And James.
So I need to activate someone. You know what? I'm going to put 3 on the digital assistant.
What?
Oh, I only get one action if I do that, right?
Yeah.
Well, it also says no player can have more than one on this character, right?
Yes, and that's anytime you're influencing a character, you should look at their purple abilities because that may interfere. In this particular circumstance, the digital assistant's really helpful. And Siri, evil Siri, whatever you want to call her, is happy to help anyone on board and is not going to listen to one player more than others. So the maximum number of cubes
stupid, helpful
you can
Siri.
Have them is one.
All right. How will I wreak havoc? What do I need to do? So there's the mainframe. Where are all the other computer places? There's that one.
There's two primary places. Yes, exactly. The security station and the mainframe.
Oh, there's already a person in there.
With the jammers off, hackers now have console access from wherever. And there are two hackers on board, the Stowaway and the Exile.
Let's bring the Stowaway in. That'll be fun. Let's do that.
Okay. So one influence cube. And you're going to move your activation disk.
Sorry.
That's fine. You're actually just going to move them from the Exile to the Stowaway. Yeah. You'll get two actions with the Stowaway. The first action must be to be placed on the map.
Where will he... I can't place them right in Vault-X, right?
You can. You can place them right in Vault-X, but sure. They're not armed. They're not going to be able to smash the section and
that's
release
true.
The critter inside.
Let's put him... let's put him here. And then my second action, I'm able to access the console, right?
That's right, using hacking.
So I'll take this lock off.
All right.
That's it, right?
Yes.
All right.
And Dan.
Two of us can be evil, Peter. Two of us.
Perfect. Okay. As we were previously talking about the purple abilities, for loyal on the chimp or the microbiologist, yes. Are you returning or your influence on all the characters or just those characters?
It will be just the ones on that character. So if someone puts a cube on the microbiologist, the next player would have to place two cubes, and the person who had one cube gets their cube back.
I see. All right. We'll have the billionaire run around like an idiot. That seems like a fine plan. He starts here.
He wants to get a yes. hammer and go after, or wrench and go after Vault X.
No. he'll take his own briefcase, I guess, sure. as his free pickup. One, two. He'll go over here and find his dog next time somebody does with him.
All right.
Moving to the security station. Perfectly yep. good. And are you done with your turn?
Yes.
All right. Peter.
Okay. So. Influence. I think I'm gonna... where's that one at? All right, so the microbiologist is...
here in the physics lab.
In the physics lab. And the purple ability on the card to influence, remove all, influence and place one more than was previously there. Well, there's nobody there yet, so that's
correct.
That's good then. So I'm going to go ahead and influence the microbiologist and move my activation token to them.
Sure.
Now
I'll just note that the science ability allows you to do any manufacturing instead of your free pickup drop. So you get a free pickup drop and you can use that. Alternatively, you could use that as a manufacturing action during that character's activation phase.
So you could promote yourself with a digital assistant, right?
He could go to the main. That's definitely an option. I don't know who any of you guys are because I haven't looked at your cards, but if you move to the mainframe, you could manufacture a copy of the digital assistant. Alternatively, you could go to the print shop and manufacture a helmet or a tool.
Right.
Or just pick up the artifact for free and be on your merry way. Well, or so the jetpack is not.
I was going to say, I think that's what the microbiologist is looking for right now. So the microbiologist is going to go ahead and pick up the jetpack.
Well, every microbiologist needs a jetpack.
Absolutely.
Sort of a Gordon Freeman.
So that was one move and a pickup. And then the microbiologist will, for the second move, head over to the forward exhaust.
Very good. Now, I'll mention that if you're thinking of going out that exhaust, you're going to need a helmet.
Correct.
Rocket pack won't... will.
Is not enough.
Throw yourself out the airline. That's something I didn't mention this rule, but it is a rule. Characters won't intentionally commit suicide generally. They have self-preservation. And so you won't just throw themselves out of airlocks or throw themselves into fire or things like that. Now, there are very specific ways in the game that might come about, but those are noted on their particular cards.
Okay.
All right. Peter, are you done?
I am done.
All right, I'm going to go ahead and move the turn marker. Approximately 12 turns left, and James.
So now I'm going to do some shiny stuff. I'm going to get this monkey going.
All right.
And all right.
Start the monkey business.
He's going to go down the ventilation shaft to here. Yes. Then he's going to go into here.
Yes.
And then he's going to grab this shiny thing.
And that's not one of his shiny things, though.
Yeah, it's okay. It's okay.
It is not.
Don't worry about it. What do you do with this thing anyway?
Okay, well, this is a little bit sooner than I expected to be talking about the antimatter, but hey, every game plays out differently. The antimatter is a bomb, and if it's ever removed from magnetic containment, it will become armed. So, for example, if the chimp takes one step out of magnetic containment, the antimatter will become armed and will flip it thusly. When that happens, we're going to set a time marker 4 turns into the future. And at that time, there's no turning it off. The antimatter will detonate 4 turns into the future. Now, if it detonates on board, okay, the game ends in Stationfall.
Oh, shoot.
Now, I'll mention that if the antimatter does become armed, abandoned ship is immediately automatically declared. Okay. And all the pods will be ready to, people can start really hustling to those pods. That's a possibility. Now, another possibility, is that the antimatter detonates EVA. So there's a eject antimatter option here. Which could be done instead. It couldn't be done instead of picking it up because you used your free pickup to do it. But that's an option. You may want to look at the eject antimatter section action in the rules. But basically, you would just throw it EVA basically from there. If it detonates EVA, you play on, but will damage every section that has an airlock. So your exhaust ports, your airlocks, and stuff like that will all be damaged, which can make things harder for the station to function the way you want them to function. Alternatively to that, the antimatter could also theoretically detonate inside a pod that has launched into the mesosphere, in which case the pod and anyone who is unlucky enough to be in that pod when it goes off is annihilated. But the game plays on normally. So, this is an important turn of events. A monkey is loose in magnetic containment and playing with the single most dangerous item on board. This probably is going out on some sort of email blast or something, especially now that the jammers are off.
They're like, don't hit it with the wall.
Put down the antimatter, Coco.
Yeah, this is pure games through and through.
Yeah. Well, that was interesting. All right.
So, James, are you done? Are you done with your turn?
That's my 2 actions, right? I can't do anything else.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, he moved twice and used his free pickup to grab the stupid antimatter.
What craziness are you going to cause?
I am sorely tempted to undo his nonsense, to be perfectly honest. Yeah, you know what? I am.
What?
I am.
What? He hasn't even left the room yet.
Yeah, no, I'm going to activate the extra chip. Take back your stupid influence cube.
Put that cube back. Now, his disc will stay here.
I'm sorry. Was that me? Yeah, no, that was me.
So you only get 1 action. What's your action?
And a free pickup drop.
Okay, so my free pickup drop will be to put the manometer back in connected containment.
Yes. Now, with your action, you certainly can just move on out of there, which is a safe thing to do. But I'll just mention that alternatively, you could use the eject antimatter, which will arm the antimatter and cause lots of danger, as I mentioned, but it will move it EVA, which isn't necessarily the safest thing in the world, but at least that's an option I want to mention. But maybe the monkey shouldn't mess with antimatter. Maybe the monkey playing with antimatter is some sort of analogy for humanity or something. You should bail out of this.
No, that is sufficient for my purposes.
All right, perfect. All right,
I just didn't want the station to explode this early.
I get it. Is there do you have any other anything else to do, Dan? And I just mentioned this because, of course, compromat is always a possibility. I can't remember who picked up a compromat and when, but that's something you can do in addition to your activation.
Okay. I didn't pick up any of the tokens yet.
Okay. And Peter.
All right, Peter's going to release Alien. No.
All right, so all right. Double checking. So I currently had activated Influence and activated the Microbiologist.
Yes.
If on this turn I wanted to use the Microbiologist again, do I need to change anything?
You don't have to change a single thing, but you will only get one action plus the free pickup drop with the Microbiologist because there's already a disc on it. Doesn't matter what color. If there's at least one disc on it, and you only get one basic action plus a free pickup drop.
Okay. All right.
Darn so I think you, I'm gonna... Dan, darn you.
I know, he just ruined it for you, James. I'm going to go ahead and influence and activate the Daredevil then, so I can get two actions.
Sure.
And the Daredevil is going to move to the tanks. And then move to the storm shelter and grab a helmet.
All right.
All right, and that's it for me.
All right, I'm going to move the turn marker. And James.
What are you doing?
What is happening?
What are you doing?
He is sold on this mission. So wait a second. So James, you put four cubes out? Did you need to put four or just three?
Healing needed to place four. If you would like to just place three, you may. However, you may place four if you want to, James.
Interesting.
No. Okay. I'm good placing four. So that means Dan has to place five.
Oh no.
Coco's getting offered a lot of bananas for this.
All right, that's all it. Right. That's all I could do. All right, Dan.
I'm sorry, what was your one action?
My one action was moving in.
And pick up the stupid thing again. Oh, yeah. Of course. Maybe we kill the chimp.
Well, you could try.
This may need to happen.
Okay. I think I will leave the chimp alone for a turn or two. We'll go back to the billionaire. He'll claim his dog. He needs his dog. Actually, we'll go one and grab the helmet as well as a second action.
Okay. I think Dan might be the billionaire. We need to kill the billionaire. To say.
Jammer's off. Everything's live streamed.
I could use anybody to kill.
Peter.
All right. So this is again just trying to understand for sure. When I activate a character, if I already have an influence cube on them and nobody else does, I can just move my activation disc to that character again?
That's right. However, I'll just say all you need is tied for the most. So even if they have a cube too, if Team White had had a cube here, that doesn't matter. As long as you have tied for the most. But if they then have two, then you can't.
Okay, gotcha. Well, for right now, I'm just going to reactivate the Microbiologist then.
And you'll get two actions.
And move one... two back to the physics lab.
Okay.
And
I'll remind regarding the science ability. in case it's relevant.
May free manufacture instead of free pickup or drop. Gotcha. I'm going to pick up the artifact out of the physics lab here and give that to the microbiologist.
All right. Anything else?
That is it for me. Nope.
All right. I'm moving the turn marker and James.
Now I can put influence cubes on a player, but not activate them.
So first of all, on a player
or on a means... on a character. Sorry, on a character.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. You may play it. You may influence any single character, and then you can choose who to activate. You don't have to activate who you just influenced.
All right. I put two on Daredevil.
Okay.
And I'm leaving it on the monkey, and the monkey is stepping out into the world.
The antimatter is suddenly angrily beeping warning as well as a timer. Let's grab a time marker for you. And I'm going to place that 4 turns in the future. So this game may have just gotten significantly shorter.
just for clarity, does the station blow up at the beginning or end of the turn?
What this brown marker means that it will blow up at the end of James's turn in this turn. During his resolve phase here, he will get a turn in turn 6.
But nobody.
The rest of you, not so much. So when it's going to blow up. The other thing I'll mention is abandoned ship is immediately triggered. So I'm going to put this here, and that will remove all the locks in the game. Although I think you guys already unlocked every dangerous thing you possibly could.
This is correct.
Now all pods can be launched.
Right.
So. That includes this weird panic pod that's attached to the corridors. That includes all these pods that are here attached to the airlocks. I'll just mention that Hail Mary has got a damage marker on it. So if you're thinking about using it to survive, that's probably a mistake unless you're going to repair it first.
How do you launch pods again?
So let's talk about pod. Now that we've triggered abandoned ship and now that the monkey has truly doomed you all, let's talk about trying to escape the station. So... there's no rescue ship right now, but in some games there is. If the border's in the game, then maybe there's a rescue ship coming. So that if without that, there's only really 2 ways to survive in your game. One is to launch on a pod. There's 5 escape pods because the panic pod is in your particular game, and then there's these other 4, one of which is damaged. So that meaningfully puts you down to 4 escape pods that you'll be looking at. You can launch from within the pod by doing the pod launch action. And the pod launch action will not immediately launch your pod. It will set a timer, and the timer will be 1 turn long. So just like James, we just triggered one for James, or we just placed one for James for being the one who moved the antimatter out. If you use an action to set McQueen's escape pod McQueen's timer, we would put your color, whatever it is, onto here. And that means at the end of your next turn, it will actually launch. So you can set a timer from within a pod, but you're not going to instantly launch. Alternatively, from the aft airlocks, you could do a section launch action. Section launch immediately launches an adjacent occupied pod. So somebody else can press the button on your pod from outside the pod and immediately jettison you. And once a pod is launched, everything on board escapes. Whatever it is, whoever it is who's on that pod escapes, and we will move them to the mesosphere. Congratulations. The slight exception is... if there's antimatter on the escape pod, obviously that may change things when it goes off. But also a damaged escape pod. If a damaged escape pod is launched, everything on board is annihilated and removed from play. So make sure you get in the escape pod that's undamaged and that it stays undamaged throughout the entirety of its timer or non-timer or whatever it is that you're planning on doing. So those are the primary methods of escape. Secondarily, because the Daredevil's in the game, there is that rocket pack, right? I forget who has it or where it is right now, but that allows you from EVA, if you're EVA, You can just escape. You can just say sayonara and just fly off into the sky on your rocket wings and go land in some resort somewhere. And that's an option as well. I'll just remind everybody that if you want to go EVA, it's a vacuum out there. You're going to need a helmet if you're a human. If you're not a human, then you won't need it. But if you're a human, you're going to need it. All right. That's it for my explanation on escape. I also want to mention a concept which I didn't introduce earlier on, but since the game has been perhaps shortened, I want to mention it. Everybody starts with one of these tokens with a B on it, and this is a bribe token. It can be used as sort of a wild card compromat. So in other words, during your turn, in addition to any compromat that you might want to use, you could bribe a character by placing a bribe token on them and do one action with them. However, having an unused bribe of your having your bribe unused at the end of the game is worth a victory point to you. So you really only want to do this if it's really important. Secondly, if they are that character, they will score points. So in other words, if Pink bribes the Exile and the Exile is a non-Pink character, then at the end of the game, the Exile actually gain a point for having been bribed. I'll also mention that player characters, which once again is just a revealed player, can decide to say no to bribes with no penalties at all. So that's what bribes mean. Since you're going to be counting your number of actions here, really be thoughtful about your victory conditions and your bonus cards. Reminder that if your bonus card has little targets on it, that does not mean you just want them to burn up on reentry. It means you want to actively seek them out and harm them before Stationfall happens. If the antimatter does end up detonating on board, that will trigger Stationfall at that time. All right. And with all that in mind, James, the evil monkey, go forth.
Well, I already did my stuff. I don't feel like bribing anyone, so I'm good for now.
All right. Dan.
All right.
See if you can get your billionaire to escape.
Yeah, my billionaire is currently active. I don't really want to move him.
You should hit the billionaire with a wrench from the medical person, and then you can heal him. Or not.
I'll put a cube on the kernel here.
I'll pause for just a second. Reminder to look for those abilities.
That's right. Can't do that unless I have somebody that's in that same room, right?
That's right.
Okay. We'll play with the engineer then. He'll just go 1, 2 and pick that up.
Very good. Are you done, Dan?
That should be it.
And Peter.
All right.
I'm saying you might as well release the alien at this point. See what it is. It's okay if it's a black hole. Don't worry about it.
To release the alien, you have to go to Vault X. If damaged, release Project X and transfer ownership.
Or an officer from the cryo lab or an officer from the bridge can do it. Or if you're really desperate, you could try to damage a bunch of the power state sections on the ship. But that would be...
Okay, on the officers or the engineer and the colonel.
Yes, or any character that possesses the digital assistant.
Right, but to do that, I have to release the digital assistant. Somebody has to go to the mainframe, right?
Yeah, you could take the...
Could do with the exile.
Exile, go here, copy the digital assistant.
To anybody.
Yourself. Oh, sorry. Didn't mean to do that. Thanks.
And then move them. And then, yeah, the next turn you could do it.
I don't know. I feel like that's going to be... There's not a lot of turns left now.
Oh, don't worry about it. The chimpanzee's having fun. He's having a great
time
with an antimatter bomb.
So if I go up here, if I go up to the daredevil and I match James's cubes...
Yes.
Then I can move the activation disc back.
You might.
And do I still get two actions or just one?
Two actions. Actions only based on the number of discs.
Gotcha.
Or presence of discs.
Presence of discs.
What's the daredevil to do?
The daredevil.
Well, things got exciting in a hurry, so.
I'll say.
One. If you go up this tube.
Yeah, you'll be
into the forward hub.
That's correct.
All right, two.
Excellent.
Anything else, Peter?
That is going
to
be it.
Let's see. You just moved to. If you want to use your free pickup at the start of your action.
Oh, I could have. Yeah, I could have picked up the compromat. Yeah, let's go ahead and do that. And that goes into my hand.
That's right.
And then
I'm going to move the turn marker, and the beeping on that package with the chimp is getting louder.
I mean, oh, that's sad. All right. where's that medical?
Now James is like, how can I make this actually happen sooner than everybody thinks?
Well, I did use up all my influence, so hopefully someone will take control of the Astro Gem. But in the meantime...
Nope!
I got things I can do. So I could do the stowaway. You know what, the stowaway? He really likes life and clobbering people. The two things he likes in life. So he is going... Go ahead.
I'm
going
to interrupt you just for a second, James, because you're out of cubes. I just want to mention that if you reveal, regardless of how you reveal or whatever, you would place your eyeball on you, whoever it is that you're revealing as. And then you can always activate that character, regardless of where your other cubes are. But I'll also mention that, let's say the Colonel looked like this, and then Team Pink revealed as the Colonel. They would place their little eyeball up here. The pink cubes get returned to them. The purple cubes, which are not theirs, go to what we call the betrayal box, which is a bad place where cubes go to die. And so basically you've backstabbed Team Purple by revealing as someone they were using as part of their own conspiracy. So that's partly part of how on reveal works. So like when you reveal at the beginning of a turn as somebody, just since we may be a little low on turns here, it certainly should be crossing everyone's mind to be thinking about revealing as their characters or trying to decide who to reveal as given the circumstances. But that's how the cube mechanic plays out. And then no one else can influence that character. If you've revealed as a character, nobody else can influence them. You are not listening to anybody else anymore. You are following your own destiny.
Now, so you get more points if you don't reveal your character, right?
At the end of the game, you will be forced to reveal your character. Whether who you decide to reveal as is up to you. But of course, revealing as your secret identity rather than as your one of your bonus cards gives you the most possibility for points, but of course that depends on how things played out. I mean, you'll have to look at your cards and make a decision.
Well, I'm fine.
Once you reveal as somebody, you lock in as them. You are them. You won't be anybody else.
Yeah, I'm fine right now with just doing the stowaway. Because he's going to come over here. He's going to pick up this nice little thing right here. And okay, the stowaway can use air ducts, right?
Take a look.
Step through events.
Looks like it.
So he's going to go right here, right? Oops, dang it. He's going to go right beside this daredevil person. Let's see what I got going here.
All right. Are you done, James?
So if I use the evidence or whatever that I picked up on there, I can do one action. Or compromat. I can do one action with that, right?
Yes.
Does that include a free pickup?
Does not.
Okay. Okay, so I'm good for right now.
So I'm glad you went over all that stuff about what happens when you reveal, because I think I'm going to reveal now.
Okay.
He can't activate anyone else on the board then? Any of their
characters? No rules change other than the fact that he can activate himself, but he'll still be comparing cubes.
You better not
to
be
other
the
players.
Chimp.
So do I just dump my cards over or on
you
the
will,
table over here?
You will not reveal your bonus. First of all, are you revealing as your secret identity or as one of your bonus cards?
I'm revealing as my secret identity.
Okay, then you will just reveal your secret identity. You'll place it face up in front of you.
Okay.
And you will not reveal your bonus
son
card.
Son of a...
And, are you serious? Are you really the chimp?
I am really the chimp.
Wow.
Oh, my gosh.
That is an epic backstab.
Oh, no.
You don't even have any shiny stuff.
I know
he doesn't have any shiny stuff. I'm going to try to fix that right now.
You going to drop the antimatter and get some shiny stuff?
No, you are still carrying a live munition here.
I know. 1, 2. He's going to go over here. Now, what do you call it? Just to be clear, I can hypothetically next turn hop into the panic pod and drop the antimatter.
Yeah. Yes. You
and then
you would,
watch it at some.
Yeah. You would the way to do all this would be to get into the panic pod, drop the antimatter, set the timer, and then get out before that timer runs.
Okay.
Right. And maybe fair. Pick up a shiny gun on the way if you're feeling lucky. But
all right. So yeah, now I'm just moving two, and I'm going to pick up the compromat that's in the kitchen on my way this
turn.
Very
good.
Oh, that was epic.
Oh, yeah. When he explained how terrible James would be set back when I would do that, I had to do it.
That is a... That monkey...
he's the bane of my existence. I'm going to have to hit him with a wrench.
Are you done, Dan?
Yes.
All right. And we are going to Peter.
All right. Well, I might as well reveal because James knows... And James is trying to do something about it. So I'm revealing my actual character, not one of my bonuses.
Okay. And who are you?
I am the Daredevil.
Yeah.
James knew it.
Oh, it's another devastating betrayal for James.
You know what? You guys, you're horrible people.
You started it. You made the monkey pick up the big bomb, dude.
Hey, it needs to happen.
All right, now you may activate any of your conspirators that you would like to.
All right, so this would still stay the same though, since I already have my activation disc on the Daredevil. I still would only get one movement.
Yes, you would only get one action.
Right, one
and
action
and a free pickup or drop.
Right.
I still think, Dan, you just
question. I do have a question about the compromat again. You were saying that's a beyond a regular action.
Yes.
What does that do specifically again?
You get to do, so in addition to your activation phase, whatever, you know, whoever you put your disc on and do stuff with,
mm-hmm.
You can play a compromat and do a single action with that character, regardless of really who they are. If it's the chimp, then we have to have a conversation because the chimp can say no and become a suspect.
Okay.
But any of these other characters would just do what you say.
So even though they're not currently activated by me because I have their secret, they'll do something that I want them to do.
Exactly.
Okay. I'm going to leave my activation disc on the Daredevil. And move one space.
Okay.
To the physics lab. I'm going to. There's nothing to pick up or drop in that space.
There's not.
I'm going to then play a compromat. Do I show that?
Yep.
In front of myself.
Place it face up in front of you.
And that's the stowaway.
Okay.
And I'm going to tell the stowaway to go away, right? Does that work? Like I can move it a space or something?
Any action you want to do, movement is the obvious one here. Although the stowaway is a hacker. If you wanted the stowaway to hack something for you, you could.
If jammer,
you can't lock anything anymore because of abandoned ship, but you could do something with a drone or turn the jammers back on.
Oh, interesting. Interesting. Drone. Okay. I think I'm just going to have it move. Yeah, I'm going to send the stowaway to the biolab where they, I guess, gain contamination.
Yes, that's true. By stepping foot into this god-awful place, the stowaway has come down with some sort of growth. All right.
Perfect.
All right, so you took your two actions, your one action, I should say, for your activation, and you've played a compromat. Is there anything else you'd like to do?
No.
All right, I'm going to go ahead and move the turn marker. Let's see here, James. I just want to mention, because you are in, let's call it cube stress, due to the epic betrayals.
Yeah, the epic betrayals. It's okay. It's okay.
You've got two perfectly qualified conspirators who can go do stuff for you. But I just want to mention, alternatively. Under your sequence of play, it says activate, but it also says slash renegotiate. Renegotiate is if you don't want to do an activation, you can instead return a cube and your activation. You return your activation disc from wherever it is, but you can also return a single cube from play that's not on an escaped character. So if you wanted to renegotiate because you don't care about the stowaway anymore because they've got this awful cough or whatever, that would be an option. The other thing I want to mention is the Therapy Gardens meditate section action. If you go there with a PC, so in other words, a PC is a revealed player. So there's two of them right now, right? The mm-hmm. Daredevil's a PC and the Astro Chimp's a PC. And we don't know who you are. But if you yourself personally were able to reveal and go to the Therapy Garden and do a meditate, you would get all of your cubes back from betrayal. So you've been betrayed a lot. It's going to take some therapy or something to get over this. You could go to the garden and try to motivate yourself to get back into this thing. Alternatively, you can just try to accomplish your tasks with the flunkies that you have, which are perfectly valid choices right now. But that's where we're at. I'll also mention that we are extremely low on time on the antimatter. It's going to be very difficult, I think, to launch that pod with the antimatter. Because that's going to be pretty tricky.
So my suggestion is...
There's no airlock there to launch the pad from outside of it, so you have to launch the pad from what, the control room?
Where the bridge could do it using a bridge launch, but there's no one anywhere near the bridge. It's possible the best way to get rid of this antimatter is not to try to set a timer on the panic pod, which I think is going to take too much time, but instead to try to get it to magnetic containment and eject it, or just go throw it EVA out of something. It's hard to say. The problem is that pod's going to have a timer, and I don't think the math works out.
My token's on the chimp, and I only have two turns before it blows up.
Hey, you might need Peter to bribe you or something,
Dan.
I'll
make you a deal. This is the deal. What's that? I will launch you. Just leave the antimatter on the station. Jump in the shuttle.
and I will make sure you get launched.
Dan, don't do it.
Jump in the shuttle.
Then the chip doesn't score any victory points.
This, you can pick up the gun.
No, yeah, I mean you would get 3 victory points for escaping.
And you get a victory point for the gun. You just
not if the antimatter's in the pod with me.
No, drop the antimatter before you get in the pod. And I will launch the pod with you in it.
Why would you do that?
Yeah, Dan, exactly.
I promise that will happen.
No, Dan.
You need to leave the antimatter on the station and you will escape. That's the deal. I'm going to go ahead and reveal myself to show you that I'm going to do it. I'm the engineer. I don't need escape. Your cube gets lost. And I am evil. So. Oh, whoops, not, I put it on the... Yeah. So, that's the deal. You drop the antimatter and you get on the pod. And I launch you.
This feels really bad. Why does he want the chip to survive?
Don't do it, Dan.
Well, I want the antimatter on the station. It's a compromise.
Yeah. So, Dan, if you go on...
If the 3 victory points if antimatter detonates on board before station fall...
Right.
Yep.
Oh, he wants the antimatter on board, so...
Yeah, he doesn't want it to get away.
Okay. Also, I also have permission to launch pods, because I have that.
I'm sorry, how are you planning on launching the pod?
I have to get to one of the terminals, right?
To launch that pod...
You have to be inside it or at the bridge.
So I have to get all the way down to the bridge.
Yes.
Well, you just drop the antimatter, get inside the pod, and launch it. You're done.
I launch it. Okay.
You could launch it, and that'd be fine. You know who I am. I guess I didn't need to reveal myself at that point, because I was just going to clobber people. Because I don't care if I'm guilty.
All right, well...
That's what you guys look at.
I guess since I live, I'm okay with this plan.
All right, now, since I revealed... I get to place a timer on a section, which is the best section would probably be this section. How does that work out?
You will place a timer on a section, and you'll damage that section when your timer resolves. What do you want to what section do you want to damage?
This one right here. So just to ensure them to get out, because that slows them down, trying to move anywhere else, and then.
Damaging the kitchen will not. You can move in and out of damaged sections.
How long does it take the section to get destroyed?
It will. There's no destroying of sections except for pods, I suppose. You will prevent people from making snacks and doing refrigerator related actions in the kitchen if you damage it.
If I put it here, they can't do.
They won't be able to eject it from the magnetic.
What if I put it there?
Then
they won't
be
able to launch the airlocks from inside, but they'll still be able to launch them from outside.
Okay, can. This will make it very difficult to get rid of the antimatter because they won't be able to throw it out the airlocks, which won't function anymore if it's damaged. And
all right, so that's what I'm going to do. So hopefully, Dan will take that option.
I'll just mention that when you set a timer from within a pod, we place a time disk, and it doesn't launch until the end of your next turn.
So that time disk. That one would launch at my next turn. This would break that or whatever.
Yes, at the end of your next turn, that's gonna break.
Okay, Dan, leave with an antimatter behind. Now I'm gonna do some fun stuff. What do I want to activate?
Yeah, it doesn't necessarily have to be the engineer.
Oh man, this is the best character in the world for me. I must say, he's so awesome.
It is. It is James Incarnate.
So good. So good. Now, if only I could hit people. Because I need people not to... I guess it does. Yeah. I guess no one's contaminated.
Wrong.
There's two
Stowaway is contaminated.
There's two characters that are contaminated. Stowaway and
Microbiologist. But they don't have weapons.
Nope. The only person with the weapon right now is the medical droid.
Okay. So anyway, I'm going to activate. I'm going to activate my guy.
Okay.
Where is he? He's right here. He is going to do one, two, and go into the therapy room. Is that legal?
Yes, it is.
All right, and he's going to pick up more of this. And how many of these am I allowed to play a turn?
One.
So I'm going to throw it.
Bribe if you would like to.
I'm going to bribe the daredevil.
You're going to bribe the daredevil, or are you going to use compromat on
that? I'm sorry. I'm going to use compromat on the daredevil.
Very good.
So even though I'm revealed, that still works, right?
This is the way it works when you're revealed.
Yeah.
James is going to say an action that he wants the daredevil to do. You can say yes or you can say no. But if you say no, then you become a suspect and we'll move your disc to suspect status.
Okay.
Now, at this point, if that antimatter is going off, then being a suspect is probably neither here nor there. But that doesn't prevent the use of the compromat or anything
right.
like that. And maybe it's an action you even want to do. So it's sort of it can be used in different circumstances. But the first thing, James, what action would you like the daredevil to do?
What does it mean when
you from uploading embarrassing things?
Yeah. What does it mean in this phase? All data here is deleted. There's no data there, is there?
Not currently. So
the physics lab, if any data goes in there, it gets deleted immediately. There is no data in there, so we don't have to worry about that. Data is a very specific concept in the game. It's these diamond tokens, okay. including the evidence and things
so
like that.
So what I want to do is move you to this mainframe.
You only get one action, though, right?
That's one action.
Yes, one action to move to the mainframe. So, Daredevil, would you like to go to the mainframe, or do you want to become a viral sensation?
Upload that video.
All right. So,
I'm
if he becomes guilty by some means, then he can't win, right?
That's correct.
Okay.
Oops, I moved it. Okay.
Oh, so good being evil.
All right, are you done, James?
I can't legally do anything else, can I? I can't bribe someone in addition, right?
You can bribe somebody in addition.
And then bribing a revealed character, they can ignore the bribe?
Yes, they can say no, and you won't lose your bribe, and they won't lose anything.
Oh, so they could just... they don't go up, like, becoming more of a suspect or anything, right?
No.
Okay, I'm good.
Dan.
All right. So if I want to escape with the chimp, I got to do it this turn so it leaves next turn, the turn before the thing explodes.
Yeah. That's the problem is you only have one action because you've activated yourself here.
But you can,
but I get a free pick
drop,
up or drop.
You can drop the animator and move into the shuttle.
But yeah, I can't launch the pod. Because that's another action.
Yes.
But you will he make it if he does it the next turn?
I don't think he's going to make it because
the antimatter will blow up at the end of your turn.
Is there any way that he can be once he's in that pod he can be launched?
Only if somebody goes to the bridge and does it.
Oh, okay.
But nobody's near the bridge. It has to be an officer at the bridge or somebody with data, right? Digital assistant could do it.
Yes.
I mean, I could with the stowaway. No, I couldn't do it twice.
The stowaway at least can hack. So as long as the jammers are off, maybe? I don't know. Wait a second. So,
Dan, weirdly enough, despite the fact the panic pod is right here and of course waiting for you with a glorious handgun inside, I don't see a way to survive trying to do that, but it is at least possible with Peter's assistance to survive by going out and using the eject antimatter action in magnetic containment. So you'll notice that your Astro Chimp has the Zero Born ability now that they are revealed. That means you get a free step into zero, free step instead of free. Oh, that's actually mislabeled.
Free step.
It should be a free step into zero gravity. That would allow you to activate yourself this turn and move to the kitchen and then get a free step to the reactor. Right. And then if someone bribes you into the magnetic containment, you'll get one more turn where you could flush it out with your last possible remaining remaining action. Alternatively, if you just move somebody else this turn, you could probably make it work anyways. But Peter has to be on board. He's got to be willing to bribe you to keep the antimatter out of play. Is the only conceivable way I can see. And I'm not, you know, I hesitate to offer advice, but I know you went running to that pod thinking you could launch it.
What do you call it? I didn't take full consideration of the antimatter problem when I made my move last turn.
Yes.
So is there no way that anyone could launch that pod for him?
I mean, it would take too much time, right?
I think so. Actually, I don't think you need Peter on board because of Zeroborn. I think you could do a free move into the magnetic containment and then launch it with your next action. So you might be okay if you just make a beeline for the magnetic containment and try to launch
it. Well, Astrum's already activated, so even with my free move, I would only move twice to the reactor.
And then you get one more turn.
Oh, I see. I'd activate him again next turn.
Mm-hmm.
And then I would be able to move for free and then eject.
Yes, move for free, drop, and eject.
Yeah. All right, we're double crossing James again. We're not going. I'm sorry, James. This seems to be the only way we all survive.
I don't care if you all survive. I was just trying to keep the chimp alive.
That's what you were doing.
All right, that is everything I could do, is just move twice.
Yes, no compromat or anything like else.
Let me take a look at this. I don't think so. No. I'm good.
All right, Peter.
Well, Peter's just gonna try to escape. All you people and you're escaping.
All right, so we're getting kind of close here, so I do have a question about the Daredevil.
Yes.
So he's been revealed, or they have been revealed.
Yes.
Point Break. At Stationfall, if you possess a helmet, I do.
Yes.
Are co-located with the rocket pack. I am, because the microbiologist has it. Does that meet the requirement of co-located?
Co-located just means in the same section.
Okay. And I'm not down, then I can escape. So I don't even have to be at an EVA.
That's correct.
But that Stationfall does have to happen.
Well, yes. Stationfall is going to happen, right? Stationfall is now going to be when the bomb blows up.
Yes.
That's still considered station fall.
That's correct.
Fantastic.
So he's just getting.
If the bomb blows up on the station, right?
I'm just saying, if the bomb is about to blow up, I'm still technically okay right where I am.
Yes, that is a very tenuous truth, but it is true right now.
It's true at this moment.
Tenuous truth. I like that.
Don't,
I like that.
Don't put it past James to try to figure out a way to still make this bomb go off. All right, so I'm going to then activate the microbiologist, I think. Is that what I want to do? The stowaway. Why am I going down there? Stowaway is over here in the bio lab. Vault X. I'm still kind of interested in this Vault X and releasing this crazy monster. Would the stowaway have to have something like a weapon of some kind or a tool to damage?
Yes, you'll need at least a tool. You could also detonate a firebomb in there.
Okay, but they don't have any of those things currently.
Correct.
Right. Or if you can get a kernel to that cryo lab.
Or any character with a digital assistant here in the cryo lab, yes.
Yes.
See, you're, what do you call it? The stowaway you were looking at is a hacker, and the jammers are off. So you can use hacker to basically promote anyone with the digital assistant.
Yes.
That's not quite right. You have to go to the mainframe to create a copy of the
digital assistant. Yep.
Yeah. Okay. So I don't think that's going to happen. So I'm going to go ahead and activate the microbiologist. The microbiologist is going to drop the artifact.
Don't do that.
Oh, it's a shiny.
No, I don't think I like that.
You can drop it, but you could also just give it to the Daredevil.
Okay, is that a thing? Okay.
Is one of the...
Yep.
That sounds like a bad idea.
Give is one of the actions. So, yeah, give... The artifact will be given to the Daredevil.
That's one action. That's not a free pickup or drop.
That's an action.
Are you going to give him the rocket pack too, just to make sure?
I mean, I would.
I mean, I could be mean and bribe the microbiologist to leave you.
Right. Yep. So I will give both objects.
Okay.
And that will be the microbiologist's turn.
All right. Are you done, Peter? Anything else? Any compromat or anything else weird?
Nope, I am done.
Okay, I'm moving the turn marker. this is everyone but James's last turn if that antimatter detonates on board.
Okay, so my question is, I can use compromat and bribe on a turn, right?
You may, yes.
All right, it's happening. But first, I'm going to activate something. So it's either going to be the stowaway or the exile. And you know what? I really, really want to see what that is. So he's going to go over to the mainframe. Oh, he won't make it, though. He won't make it. There's nothing cool to grab anywhere near me. I don't think. Yeah, whatever. I'm going to go to the mainframe. I'm going to do mainframe-y things.
Okay.
Hack that system.
I can't put any locks up, right?
Correct.
Okay. I can perform drone actions.
Yes.
The drone has a tool, right?
Drone 100% has a tool.
So, where the heck is the drones? Right here? Can the drone hit someone?
One in the physics lab and one in the EVA. Yes, this drone could attack a co-located human that didn't have a helmet. So that means the microbiologist.
Yes, right, he's going to hit the microbiologist.
All right. And this is what they call a suspicious act, murdering somebody with the cameras on in a lit section. So we're going to promote you to suspect status.
Okay. All right. So I think that's two actions, right?
That is two actions. One to move in, one to do class two felony. All right.
I'm going to use this on medical robot.
Medical droid. Okay. All right.
It's going to go here.
Wait, what's happening with the medical robot?
I'm just moving him here.
He's using compromat on the medical
robot. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I missed that part. Compromat on the medical robot to move them there. Yes.
Yes. And then I'm going to bribe the robot. And the robot happens to have a wrench. So he's going to hit the chimpanzee.
Told you, Dan.
And the chimp is cut short.
That's it. Now it's going to blow up. Now it's going to blow up.
I never bet against James.
Oh.
So the only one that's going to escape is Peter.
Why? Why would you do such a thing?
I told you what to do. No. Just die.
It wasn't going to work.
Oh, don't worry about semantics.
You told me what to do, but it wasn't going to work.
Don't worry about semantics. All right. Have fun on your death turn.
Okay. James, are you done?
I think I can't do anything else, like, literally.
Yes, that's true.
Oh, this does go off.
Yes, that great point. That damages the aft airlocks.
Oh, man. Which
prevents those airlocks from
being
used.
I am the most evil person on the planet. This is awesome.
So, Pete, I think you've just won by default.
Oh, I don't know. No, I get a lot of points.
He's going to get a lot of points.
We'll count the score, guys. it may be closer than you think, but it may also depend on bonuses. But yes. It does look like the game is going to be ending here momentarily. Dan, what would you like to do? Is there anything you can do to score more points this turn?
Oh, yeah. One of your other people, you could try to get them somewhere safe.
Chimp has a 5 cube limit. You're not even close to being over that. Gape is unlikely with all the damage and all the other stuff, but if there's a bonus card for downing somebody, that may be an option. Or you could try to otherwise try to mess with the engineer or Daredevil.
Oh, you should mess with the Daredevil if you can. That robot's right there. But you don't have a gun. It's always great when you have a game that lets you be evil.
I'm checking this out. I'm checking this out. I don't think I could do anything with that person. And I don't think I can do anything with that person, actually.
I mean, you can't even hit my guy's revenge.
I mean,
it would take some bribery to get that done.
What I call it? You did reveal yourself as the engineer, right?
Yeah,
so if I bribe you, you can just say no.
Yes.
If I happen to compromise you, it's still only one action, right?
Yes, it's still only one action.
One action does not, like, ruin any grandiose plans here, I don't think.
Yeah, my guy's fine dying. I don't need him to escape. He lived his life.
Dan, if you have no meaningful options on your final turn, you can renegotiate and take a cube back. Cubes can be in your pool, can be the tiebreaker at the end of the game. However, I think you've been removed from contention. Let's go with that.
Given the fact that everyone knows I'm the Astrochimp, and I mean, I can use the medical droid to resurrect the Astrochimp, but then the bomb's still going to go off next turn.
Well, now this is an interesting. You've perhaps. I didn't see it, but I think, Dan, that you have actually discovered a way to do it. I honestly can't believe it, but there is a way for the medical robot is key here. You can take a look at the medical robot's ability and.
Okay, let me take a look at this.
I don't know if you've used your bribe yet or not, but. There's at least potential in there somehow.
Come on, Dan. You can figure it out. It's in there somewhere.
You can't step into because he's already there.
That is correct. Can I take the bomb off the chimp?
You could, medical robot could pick up the antimatter as a free action if you activate the medical robot.
Oh, so the medical robot could maybe eject it.
So pick up for free.
Mm-hmm.
Move into the magnetic containment and then use the eject action?
Yes, the eject antimatter, I think, requires the antimatter to be unpossessed. So I better check this. What's it say? Eject antimatter is the name of the action. So we'll go to the, if it's in magnetic containment and not possessed, we perform this action to move antimatter.
So you can only drop it.
So I can only drop it into magnetic containment.
And then you can't do it.
Yes.
And then I can't.
You could bribe medical to get it done.
Can he? Because I have. Oh, yeah, I guess.
Okay. No, that's what we're doing then. Dropping it. And then we're going to use our bribe token to get rid of it.
To launch it, EVA.
Can I retrieve it?
It's just an object sitting out there, EVA, right now. That's all I can say. With a really short fuse.
Yeah.
All right.
Dan, are you done?
Yes.
So theoretically, okay, go ahead.
Peter.
Okay, so I'm just trying to follow all the shenanigans that just happened.
Yes.
So the medical robot went in here and then EVA'd the bomb.
Yes, use the section action, eject antimatter, to flush the antimatter out into space.
Okay, and so when he activated it, that was how he could pick it up, and then when he bribed it, that's how he could drop it?
Yes, I think whether the bribe was used to drop it or use the section action is irrelevant, but he did need to do that because he was one action short.
I gotcha. Yep.
But the medical robot is open for business and happy to accept donations, anonymous donations to the Red Cross or whatever.
Okay. Just trying to remember this as well. The digital assistant needs to be. How do we get this guy activated?
Manufacture the data.
That's it.
The mainframe. So that's
it's that manufacture action.
Exactly.
Okay.
And that applies to all data and some items as well. But data is like an item, but it doesn't take up an item slot.
All right. Then I already have my cube up there. Yeah. So I will activate. No, that's not what I need. I need to shoot. Okay. I'd have to put two cubes. No, one cube. Yeah. Right? If I put one cube on the exile, then I can move my activation disc up there.
Yes.
But I only get one action.
Yep.
And that one action would be manufacture.
Yes. If you want it to be, certainly.
That's what I'm going to do.
All right. I will grab a copy of the digital assistant. I'll give it to the exile. And the exile is now effectively an officer. Anything else, Peter?
That is going to be it.
All right, I'm going to move the turn marker, and that antimatter is detonating on the end of your turn, James, and you're up.
So is there any way I can return it? What's this robot here? Can I use a robot to return it?
Drones can be used via console actions.
Okay.
And they're just like any other character. They can pick things up. You're not activating the drone, so you won't get a free pickup drop, but you can use an action to pick stuff up or throw or move or whatever you want to do.
Can I use it to throw it back into the ship?
You may, although I'll note that you've damaged the primary entry point of the aft airlocks. However, the forward airlocks are still available, so you could throw it into the forward airlocks.
All right, so all I have to do is run my little exile guy right here to at the mainframe where my activation token already is.
Yes, he only gets one action, though, and that would be to pick up the antimatter.
Oh, so I'd have to have two actions.
Yes.
Is there anyone else near stuff?
I'll note there's lots of other ways to do console actions other than being in the mainframe or the security section.
Yeah, but I don't have any. I don't think I have anyone on those things. So Stowaway is here in the bio lab. So if I actually had something on a hacker.
Yes.
Oh. I got it. I got two actions. All right. I'm going to use the exile. He's going to use the drone to pick that up.
Okay.
Then I'm going to use this compromandi on the exile.
Ah.
And I'm going to toss it into the air vent.
Okay. The exile will be blackmailed into working really quickly to get those drones to toss the ticking bomb right into the exile's own station. All right,
end my turn, suckers.
You may have left out that part when you were blackmailing him. Just throw the package back inside the station. Don't ask what's in it. It's just the package. Just throw it. We'll see what happens. You'll be fine. You're going to be just fine, buddy.
Oh, the roller coaster that is James.
I'm pretty sure my guy is guilty as heck.
You are not guilty because they can't prove anything. No one got any evidence off the station. And at the end of your turn, I presume you're done, James? Is that true?
We're going to blow up stuff.
At the end of your turn, the antimatter, which is on board the station, detonates, and we trigger station fall. So the game ends at this point. I'm going to go ahead and stop our little timer, which I started at the end of our first turn.
This character has made me so happy. So happy, Peter. So happy, Dan. Oh, I'm so happy I'm crying.
All right, so awesome. Everybody has already revealed. So let me go through scoring. I'm going to go through the ice rules here to make sure we're all in good shape here. So in player order, anyone who hasn't revealed has to. Okay, we've already done that. Deliver data, and then nobody escaped at all. Did everybody die? Is this an all hands situation? Looks like it.
What is it?
Everyone normally characters that escape can deliver their data, so they can. They can give it to whoever they want to. If they want to give it to the authorities or the news or the corporation, they can do so. But since nobody escaped, there's no data.
The daredevil escapes, right?
Oh, the daredevil does escape. The daredevil does not possess data.
I don't possess data, but the daredevil does escape.
Yes, that's... Well, that's
does that have to be important. Done on his turn or no?
I'm going to give you the big...
I'm sorry, it's his special ability that's there.
Yes.
Because he revealed...
Yes, that's exactly right. If he had not revealed, if he had not revealed until station fall, he would still get it, because he would get that reveal power at the reveal phase.
Peter
of station
me,
fall.
What do you get, Peter?
You could have ambushed him theoretically, but I think it was pretty hard.
You're the only person.
I think they knew what you were up to. Secret seemed like it was out to me. All right, scoring down characters. Okay, blah blah blah. Primary points. So I want to talk about primary points. So we're going to go with James. So these are the points on your secret identity in the bottom left corner of your identity card. James is the engineer. The antimatter detonated. That's 3. No contaminated characters escaped. So that's 4 more. So that's 7. The artifact did escape. So you do not score those 2, and you are not innocent due to your horrible crimes on board, including the brutal murder of a hapless chimp, very confused chimp trying to do the right thing. So that's 7 primary points James.
I'm pretty sure Peter tied me.
I'm pretty sure I did.
Dan, I got nothing. I got nothing.
Indeed, no primary points for being atomized and being the cause of this whole debacle by moving that antimatter out in the first place. So I'm gonna write a 0 here, which is honestly 0 is a respectable score in this game. It's fairly common that we get negative scores, but we'll get into that. All right, and Peter, as the daredevil, you should have racked them up. So 3 as the escape, plus 2 more for being the only human. Plus 2 more for having the artifact is 7. The project was not released, so your primary points are also 7 points.
Yep.
Now let's talk about bonus cards. James, what were your bonus cards?
Two people I didn't get to go anywhere with.
Stowaway and the Corpsicle, both of which died on board, so that's 0 bonus points.
All right.
Dan.
Dan. His manipulations caused me to not be able to manipulate my other backup characters. So I had to kill the medical droid and save the billionaire, neither of which happened.
Yes. Now, interestingly enough, the billionaire, and I should have been more careful about this, but it has a little blue shield because actually you care about the dog's escape, not about the billionaire's. No one likes the billionaire. They just like the dog. And so you would have scored 2 points had the dog escaped. Neither the dog nor the billionaire were terrifically close. I mean, they were primed and ready to go, but there was just too many other things to do.
The medical guy did die. Does he get the point for that?
No.
He has to die before Stationfall.
Oh, okay.
Yes, exactly. All right. And Peter, what were your bonus cards?
All right. So first bonus card is the Exile, which
died.
So no points.
Yes.
And then Digital Assistant, which I don't know. I'm assuming this is a no points.
That is no points because the digital assistant did not escape. However, had you found a way to, I don't know, bribe the exile into beaming a copy to the Daredevil.
That was going to be my next move, but not enough moves.
There you go. It happens. That would have been a success because the digital assistant would have escaped. So also 0 bonus points for you. Now we're going to talk about bribes and or overages. James, did you have your bribe left over?
Nope.
No, you used it. And did you go over on cubes? I guarantee you did because you've got so much betrayal, more betrayal than anyone I've seen in recent history.
he has 2 cubes on the table.
You were the engineer. Your limit was 5. You went 8, so it's -3.
Okay.
For going 3 cubes over your limit. Dan, you did not go over your limit, and you did not have your bribe left over. So you're at a 0. And Peter.
I have my bribe, and I did not go over.
You have your bribe, so +1, and you did not go over. Puts you at a total of +1. Puts our score at 4-0-8, and Peter, as the Daredevil, is the winner.
But did he really win?
Congratulations.
I got to blow up the station.
Yep, no. You blew up the station, and as the station blows up, I'm flying away, and the Daredevil says, man, this is going to be such a good story.
That's right. It is going to be a story. And some of it was caught on film with that dog and the billionaire live streaming the whole thing. You might have some pretty epic stuff. And they're always going to have questions about exactly how what you were doing up there. There's going to be like conspiracy theories about your suspect status and stuff like that. But nobody's going to prove anything.
And the Daredevil's going to live. Sole survivor.
I was going to say that's even better than being innocent. It's perfect.
So there we are, guys. That is Stationfall, and I appreciate your time trying to learn this beast. It's very difficult to game to teach, I think, in the scheme of things. However, once it gets going, it seems like it flows pretty well. So any parting questions, thoughts, concerns, etc.?
I'm just going to jump in there first and just say well done teaching it, though, because we pulled up this on Tabletop Simulator and I was like, oh my gosh, look how much there is. And I feel like you did a really good job explaining things. And James and Dan will tell you, I'm not someone who picks up games very quickly, but I felt like you explained it very well. So I appreciate you walking us through it the way that you did.
Well, thank you, Peter. And, I'll note that the concise rules are far better than my original rules at this, and they are getting better every week. So we are hopeful that people are going to be able to play and enjoy Stationfall without having a teach in this more traditional manner. But we'll see.
Yes, and I almost won if it wasn't for that dirty Daredevil.
just the way it goes, you evil, evil being.
Oh, you murdered the microbiologist one turn too late.
That
murder goes off one turn sooner. It's a much different game for the Daredevil. But these are it's a messy game.
I also didn't know. I didn't pay attention to that point break thing. I would have tried to done probably early on, probably done more effort because I pretty much knew Peter was a Daredevil.
Yeah, you knew it. You knew it way early.
Yeah, I wanted to shoot someone, but it just didn't work out. But
that's good. We're gonna use that quote. I wanted to shoot somebody. It just didn't work out.
I was gonna actually, if I didn't lose all the people on the chimp or whatever, if I would have done a little differently, I probably would have moved the microbiologist in there to print a gun and start shooting people.
Yeah, well, you need to be an officer to print a gun, but you can tool without it. But the there's still a lot of risk until you have a helmet. If you're a human, there's a lot of risk. It all kind of depends on the situation with the cameras. It depends on a lot of little factors.
Yes.
And there's lots of abilities and lots of on reveal powers and lots of surprises in this game. And we never plenty of mechanisms that we didn't even interact with, including the horrific monster. But yeah, the idea is
the exile was going to do that too. Cause I just got the exile promoted to officer by getting the data. And so I was going to have the exile probably go there next if I could, but
yeah, and I figured the more havoc in the game would be better for me. So I was like, yeah, sure, release whatever it is.
It's definitely more fun anyways.
Eat people.
That is probably true.
Dan, what about you?
I would... First of all, even though this didn't work out for me personally, I think this is actually pretty cool. Yeah. So congrats on that. This is pretty cool. At the very beginning of the game, I sort of lacked a certain sense of direction because I didn't, you know, I had no clue what all the actions were or where I should be going or what I should be trying to do or even who I should be doing it with. Like, I knew I should probably try to manipulate the three characters that were my hand to do various things for me, but maybe manipulating some other characters besides them would also be to my benefit. I was worried about the clock on the game even before James started the stupid bomb. right?
Yeah. That monkey was already in there playing with the antimatter.
And I see that this game can play up to 9 players.
Yes.
Which just blows my mind.
9 players.
Trying to play a game like this with that many people and just the amount of havoc that would happen. And I just, again, just imagine James loving that.
Yes. That'd be amazing. And the turns would go fast because you only get 2 actions. So it'd be like bang, 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 bang.
I'm sorry. What does the play count go down to? Does it?
It goes down to 2. Okay. So the 2-player game is a little bit different than the 3-player game. In the 2-player game, you're basically playing 2-handed. So you'll have 2 different conspiracies who are cooperating, and you'll total the total score between your 2 conspiracies. It's a much more like any game that's multiplayer that turns into a 2-player game, it becomes the parties are extremely adverse to each other. So you'll be spending a lot of time just trying to muck up whatever the other player is trying to do. And trying to deduce that. But it's also a bit more chess-like because it's a lot more predictable when you're going to be getting your turn. I mean, you're going to get your turn very quickly rather than after multiple players have done their other things. I'll also note that there is an attempt to make solo rules for Stationfall. That will be a different... style of game, as I understand it, but the game, as you guys saw, goes down to 2.
Fair enough.
Yeah, I also like the. I can see there's a ton of replayability with this, all the different characters in there. So, I would.
That is the hope.
I think it is because every game you're going to have like at least a set of different people, and it's going to change it a lot.
I mean, yeah, we only saw like less than half, right?
Right. And but then you got permutations.
We had 12.
So, just swapping one out will change the game. But yeah, I really, really liked it. Any game that I that is super fun, even if you don't win, is awesome.
Well, it's easy. It's very easy to not win at Stationfall. How about that? The number of times I have not won at Stationfall is numerous.
That's okay. I had a lot of fun just trying to activate my guy's ability. I had to spend so much time doing that. I just had to forget about the other two people, even though I sort of started moving the stowaway into position.
But yeah, that's pretty normal. But that, yes, this clock was dramatically accelerated. But so be it. Every game plays out differently.
I figured I had the opportunity to do it. I might as well do it as fast as possible.
There you go.
Get the least survivors.
Well, thank you so much for introducing us to Stationfall. I think it was a rousing success. Yep. So,
well, awesome. Well, thanks for having me. The Kickstarter is April 27th, I believe, and I hope people check it out.
Yep, we'll be wishing you all the best.